This week we present another edition of Tim Catches Up with the MCU, in which Mulele and I discuss Captain America Civil War. This episode was originally published on Patreon on September 28th, 2019. Welcome to Tim Catches Up with the MCU. This is Tim on Skype with Mulele. How are you doing?
I'm good. And you?
Okay. Yeah, pretty good, actually. So we're talking this time about Captain America Civil War. And I have to say I loved this.
Oh, really?
This is my favorite one so far.
Okay. Okay. So this beats out Winter Soldier and the original Captain America.
I think my previous number one was the first Avengers movie.
Right, okay.
And I think, you know, this just scratched that itch all the more. Because I think, I mean, I was enjoying it before that point, but what I enjoyed the most was the fight at the airport. Because I feel like these movies had never quite delivered that kind of fight. You know, there's been a lot with machine guns, and, you know, some superpowered fights maybe, or maybe magical, like in some of the Thor stuff.
Yeah.
But, and of course, in this case, it's superheroes against other superheroes, which is frustrating in a way, but at the same time, you know, just that kind of fight was really fun to watch.
Well, one of the things I enjoyed so much about that fight is that there's a lot of psychology to the fight where Captain America says, "Man, you got heart, where are you from?" And Spider-Man says, "Queens." And he says, "Uh-huh, Brooklyn." And there's kind of like a friendly rivalry there between the boroughs anyway. So you're going to have that with those two characters. And it spans generations, so they both know exactly what it is. Yeah. But there's also a kind of friendly competition in the fight. They know that they're all good guys, and they're trying to settle out their difference, but they're going to do this thing that's got to be done. And some of them are a little more serious than others, but at the same time, they're trying to stop each other without hurting each other, but someone actually does get hurt. And that I liked. I didn't like that the character got hurt, because I do like that character. Sorry, this is a spoiler discussion anyway, so I don't need to be careful about it.
I mean, we've both watched it, and it's a three-year-old movie, so...
Yeah. when War Machine gets hurt, the consequences of and the fact that his Vision being distracted because he has a crush on the Scarlet Witch, I found charming. And also it kind of complicates the dynamic within the team quite a bit. Because I mean, Vision was on the side of War Machine and
Tony.
Iron Man. So it was a mistake. And Nighthawk Wing.
What, Falcon?
Thank you. He was like, oh man, I'm sorry. And Tony wasn't having it and just blasts him.
Yeah.
I found all of that stuff really endearing. I guess charming is not quite the word, but endearing about the characters. And it really kind of heightened the emotional sense of, yes, we are people who genuinely like each other. But we do have a difference in opinion, and we are stubborn.
Yeah.
We're all the alphas of our worlds.
It feels real emotionally, even if it's not real in terms of how they act it out.
Oh, the only thing you need to, and they discussed this at length with when Star Wars came out, it's a fantastic world, but the only thing you need to really ground it is a solid character. You understand the characters, everything else is kind of good. So am I supposed to believe that a robot man who has strange powers falls in love with a woman with strange powers and accidentally shoots a man out of the sky because he was aiming for someone else who was flying, and that man who got shot out of the sky would survive. I mean, it's all nonsense, really. But I mean, it's the emotional content that keeps you invested in the characters. And again, you like this film. I also like this film very much. And I'd actually forgotten how much I had liked this film. It was a pleasure to watch it again.
And even before that, like I said, there were other things that were really interesting to me. I kind of felt like they were, when they were planning the movie, they were saying, okay, what haven't we done yet? In terms of like the chase scenes and so forth, the stuff, that starts in Bucky's apartment when the German Special Forces get there, and how, Bucky grabs that railing and breaks it and bends it, and flips around to that other doorway. And then later, in the highway tunnel where he grabs a motorcycle and the guy goes flying off of it and Bucky jumps on it and goes in the other direction. That was just, outrageous, and I laughed at it, but I enjoyed it.
It was quite good. Kind of skipping ahead to the end, when Iron Man is getting pummeled by Captain America. I enjoyed the fact that there was no way that Tony Stark could actually beat him. It's an acknowledgement that Captain America is a soldier with combat training. He's special forces, and he's got super serum. And Tony Stark is a nerd in a suit. And the computer's like, sorry, we're not going to win this. And then Tony Stark's like, okay, we'll analyze his fighting style and help me out. He needed a computer assist to get a couple of licks in. And that was also very nice. And I just want to comment that the story is that this story was originally rejected by Feige when the Russo brothers brought it to him. And the only reason why it was greenlighted was because of Batman v Superman. And I think from this point, the Russo brothers took over what Joss Whedon had started. I mean, there was a shift in tone with Winter Soldier, with all the other films. But here, even more so, it plays along that course than the previous phase one and phase two stuff. And the Joss Whedon setup stuff, he directed Avengers 1 and 2. That stuff was kind of not ignored at all. It was very much appreciated for what it was, but going forward, they weren't going to try and emulate that style. They had found their new way, and they were going to springboard from that in their new direction. And I could really feel it in this film.
How so? I'm not quite putting my
Well,
finger on it.
okay, so the first Avengers movie felt rather simplistic.
Yeah,
There
it
was
was
some.
the first time they'd been together, and it was just that was kind of the point of it.
Yeah, but they were also playing to the idea of, okay, maybe you didn't see the Thor movie, or maybe you didn't see the Iron Man movie, but now they're all together, so come see this movie. And that kind of worked. They were still kind of introducing themselves as a team. And for us who were kind of following this stuff, it was mind-blowing. Man, this must have been an expensive movie to make, but they made a lot of money, so they were good. And in fact, that was the film that kind of justified in the eyes of the press why Disney spent $4 billion buying these properties. I believe it was $4 billion for Marvel and $4 billion for Lucasfilm. Looking at Age of Ultron, which was the follow-up Avengers movie, the Phase Two Avengers movie, that, to me, although it had some really good character moments, was kind of a mess, story-wise. I mean, for whatever reason, I'm thoroughly uninterested in that. And it's a fine movie, but every scene with the Avengers I liked, except when Ultron was there. When Ultron was there, I was bored out of my fucking mind. And it's not that I dislike David Spade, although I don't really like him either. I just had no interest in anything to do with that villain. But seeing that here, the villain in this piece is a very minor part of it. In fact, I thought they kind of made him up as a plot catalyst, but I understand he's actually in the Marvel comic universe.
Yes and no. Well, that was one of my only two gripes about this movie. So in the comics, he is Baron Helmut Zemo, and he has some kind of Nazi past. And here, it feels like another one of those cases where they just take the name of a Marvel character and slap it onto a character who barely resembles the character in the comic.
Wait, so if he has a Nazi past, what is he, like 80 years old?
Oh, they figure out ways to sort of de-age these characters, with magic or technology or something.
Right. Okay.
While we're on my complaints, the other one, and this is also sort of related to the comics, there are two characters in this film with the last name Ross,
Right.
and not having seen the Hulk movie, I didn't really catch that the Secretary of State was Thunderbolt Ross.
He was in the Hulk movie, yeah.
Yeah, and they never call him Thunderbolt. And in fact, in that first scene that he's in, he's just the Secretary of State. And I
Right.
don't think they ever said his name. And then Everett Ross showed up, and that popped out at me because he was a character from Christopher Priest's run on Black Panther back starting in like 1998, which is one of my all-time favorite comics runs. And but although now that version of Ross in the comic is based on Michael J. Fox, which this iteration doesn't really remind me of Michael J. Fox. That popped out at me, and then I kept hearing Ross, Ross, and here's this guy with a mustache that I couldn't quite place, and that's not the same guy who was before. And I didn't figure it out until I looked at the credits at the end. Oh, I see. And there are two Rosses. And then I still wasn't quite sure why, and then I listened to the iFanboy review of it. And oh, it's Thunderbolt Ross from Hulk. Okay. They're both from the comic, so they had to use the original names. So they were sort of stuck if they wanted to have Everett Ross in here. Although I didn't really think that having Everett Ross in this movie added anything. I thought they could have just not had him in this one and prevented the confusion. But anyway, that did kind of throw me off.
Yeah, I didn't even notice the stuff about Everett Ross. I was like, oh yeah, there's that CIA guy again. Do you really have to have the CIA involved in this? I mean, CIA is kind of a mixture of SHIELD and HYDRA anyway. But I don't know. They kind of put him as a kind of stern good guy, which is weird to me.
Now, of course, the concept of civil war is from the comics, and the basic ideas from the comic are here, although the details are all different. But they kind of got the feel of it.
So what was the story in the comics?
There was a catalyst event, completely different from the one in this movie, where some civilians died, and so the U.S. government said, "Okay, we need to register the superheroes," an element that's missing from this movie, the superheroes all had to reveal their secret identities, Now, in the MCU, secret identities aren't really a much of a thing. Most of the heroes, everybody already knows who they are. Right. Seems like Tony Stark, Steve Rogers, and then it kind of went a little bit different direction compared to the movie. But and it didn't have the Winter Soldier stuff laid directly on top of it. Although that was going on at kind of the same time in the Captain America book. Mm. And then what ended up happening was that Cap was, well, I guess technically he was actually dead. Of course, they mm-hmm. find a way to bring him back. But in the meantime, Bucky became Captain America for a while.
Right.
And I don't think that's ever going to happen in the MCU, but but who knows. Yeah. Now, something that sort of bugs me about the concept, whether it's in the comics or the movie, it feels like the powers that be tend to sort of blame the heroes for all the damage, and they don't blame the villains at all. I mean, you're not going to register the villains. So what, you know, you're going to make put someone in jail for saving the world is kind of what it ends up being.
Well, had they been able to arrest Ultron, they might be a different story. But, you know, usually when there's a disaster and you need to fix blame somewhere, you blame who's ever left over, mm-hmm. not necessarily the bad guys.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, things... Sometimes the truth is sort of hard to get at, or people misunderstand things, or someone purposely misconstrues it. Right. So I suppose it's not completely unbelievable. Mm-hmm. Also, I'm not quite sure why Cap resists quite as much as he does. Although I guess that the fact of the Winter Soldier stuff going on at the same time sort of bolsters his argument.
Mm. Okay.
There were some interesting quotes that I found on Wikipedia. Anthony Russo, you know, one of the directors, says, in a lot of ways, superhero registration can be a political issue, and we didn't want the conflict of the movie to solely exist on that level. Mm-hmm. We wanted to figure out very personal reasons why everyone's relationship to this idea of registration is going to become complicated. Mm-hmm. That's what the relationship between Steve and Bucky allowed us to do, to get very personal in terms of why people would lean one way or the other. Mm-hmm. So he said that in an interview with Empire magazine.
Right. Okay. Well, it worked perfectly for me. And although some people would say that having the reveal of Bucky was the one who killed Tony Stark's parents all those years ago is a bit too much.
Hmm.
But I didn't feel that the first time or the second time or the third time I watched this film. Felt a little bit today, but still, I did thoroughly enjoy it.
Hmm. Now, that fact was something that I got spoiled for me a few weeks ago. I can't remember exactly what I was looking at, but I think it might have had to do when, you know, with researching the whole Spider-Man Sony thing, but some article mentioned that fact that that the Winter Soldier killed Tony's parents. Like, ow. So I kind of knew that going into this movie, although I wasn't quite sure which movie that came up in until we kind of got to that point of the film. Oh, yep, there it is.
Okay, let me ask you something. In the film, Tony Stark asks Captain America, did you know? Mm-hmm. And he says yes, but it's filmed in such a way that I felt like maybe we should also know that he knew.
Yeah, we don't have any background, you know, because the fact of what happened is being revealed to us here. And so, you know, if we had known before whether Cap knew or not, then that would have spoiled the reveal.
I guess it just kind of seemed, well, how did he know? Where did he know from?
Yeah, yeah.
I was kind of wondering about that. But they're kind of a little too slick for some of their details sometimes. They mention it in one line at the beginning of the film, and then the rest of the film, I've got to kind of hold that information like it's gold. But I don't know. So, I mean, a lot of these details, you kind of look at it and say, okay, that's superfluous. I just let that one go and just focus on the main story and just enjoy it viscerally. Let it wash over me. But with a Marvel film, at this point, you can no longer do that. You have to absorb all the details. Everybody is a character from somewhere. Even background characters sometimes pop up. It's like, oh, this character was there all along, but actually, this person is a superhero. It's like, wait a minute, really? And I look it up in the comics, and it's like, yeah, she was. And when everybody said their name 3 films ago, they knew. I was the only dumbass in the room. But I don't know. Sometimes I feel it's a little bit too sly, a little too slick. How could I say the self-referential styling of Marvel films is a little beyond masturbatory.
Wikipedia also quoted a couple of reviewers talking about sort of the implications of this movie. So the first one is Scott Mendelson in Forbes. Saying with the film seemingly continuing plot threads first introduced in Age of Ultron, he wonders to what extent the whole consequences galore narrative of Civil War will improve Age of Ultron. As much great stuff as that movie has, it ultimately shows the main hero foolishly or recklessly bring a world-killing threat to Earth, and lots of really bad stuff goes down, and yet no one seems to care at the end. What does it mean if Civil War does retroactively improve Age of Ultron? Will we be at a point where we really can't judge a franchise installment on its own merits because a future installment may well fix the flaws a couple years down the line?
I believe that that's what producers are hoping for now, because no film exists in its own context. And I think a couple of episodes ago, I mentioned about maybe it was last episode, the Batman v Superman Flash thing. There's also a kind of dream sequence where, Superman is a bad guy. America is a dust bowl, and Batman is wearing a leather trench coat. It's never explained. It's never referred to again. Not in the same film, anyway.
Yeah, I think you brought that up in the context of Ultron, where we had Scarlet Witch putting the various heroes into these sort of trance states and seeing these visions, and I was complaining a little bit that it didn't really seem necessary.
But I mean, this is the thing where I think producers of these films are now looking at each film as a part of a thing that they can either refer to the future or the past, and it doesn't matter. Eventually, you'll figure it out.
Yeah, if you watch
And
all the movies.
but why wouldn't you? If you like it, if you're in it, you're in it. If you're not, you're not. And I think this has something to do with episodic TV. It used to be like Gilligan's Island, everything would reset at the end of the episode. But now everything is one long continuum with story threads that you pick up sometimes years apart. And so for Winter Soldier, it was 2014.
I guess it must have been, yeah.
2014. I've got a list here. And Age of Ultron was 2015, and now Civil War is 2016. So for 2 years, they've been running these plot threads. But actually, the first 10 minutes of this film, Civil War, the first couple of times I watched this film, I was like, who the fuck is that villain in the beginning of this? And then I went back and watched Civil War. And not Civil War, Winter Soldier, and said,
Oh,
oh, it's
Rumlow.
that guy. Yeah. I didn't remember the name, didn't recognize the face, and they talk about him like he's like he's something, and I'm just like, but he's a 10-minute villain at the beginning.
Yeah, so it didn't even say his villain name from the comics, which is Crossbones. And yeah, the first time I watched this movie twice. The first time I watched it, I couldn't remember his the name Brock Rumlow either, and I didn't even notice that they were saying his name several times. And when I first watched it, I was thinking that it was a reveal when he took his mask off, but not necessarily, I guess, because they knew who they were chasing. So, but yeah, I was really surprised. But it's the same thing they did with Baron von Strucker in Ultron. Just kind of use him in the first 10 minutes of the movie and kill him.
Baron von Strucker.
Yeah, I remember the guy who had Wanda and Pietro in captivity and gave them their powers with that Mind Stone.
Right.
Another quote from that I got from Wikipedia. This is Graham McMillan in The Hollywood Reporter, saying he felt Marvel was in an awkward place with Civil War regarding superhero destruction going forward. He wondered how superhero oversight would actually prevent the kind of destruction that it's meant to stop, unless the bad guys all agree to play by the new rules as well. Worse still, the destruction caused by superhero fights should now be foremost in viewers' heads, as it was in mine as I was watching the airport scene and all the property destruction. The audience won't be able to enjoy the sight of the Hulk smashing a random minion through a wall without thinking of the property damage and/or whoever was standing on the other side of that wall. After Civil War, can Marvel go back to pretending that everyone is okay after any large-scale event ever again? Now, you've seen everything after. I don't know if they sort of reset and forget this or not.
Marvel so far has not reset anything. Everything leads to something else. And that's kind of the point that I'm getting at here, is that everything leads to something. So no point of this film is wasted in the future films.
Now, I do know that, Avengers, after this point, they're going cosmic, and so it's not even damage on Earth anymore, I imagine.
Well, the
Well, except that I know half of Earth dies at the end of what's it call it? The next Avengers one, not Endgame, but Infinity War.
Infinity War, well, that was the thing. The half the universe was at stake for Infinity War, and so the stakes just the stakes keep going up. It's no longer an Earth problem. But they went cosmic with Guardians of the Galaxy. They went mythic with Thor. They went magic with Doctor Strange. And I guess the first thing that they dealt with was technology with Iron Man. So you've kind of got every aspect of sci-fi fantasy covered. Actually, they did magic with Scarlet Witch before Doctor Strange. So, yeah, everything or anything goes at this point. It just has to be kind of grounded in the characters and the stakes, I guess. But not so much of a spoiler, but I am going to give a little bit of a hint at how I feel about Infinity War. That film starts and it keeps going until the end. It's a non-stop action movie with stakes that are really, really high. And for me, that is my favorite MCU movie. Everything that we're kind of watching now gets explained less and less in future films. And it kind of comes to head in that film. Bad guy shows up and they're off. And that's it. You get some explanation along the way, but pretty much you're only explaining the main threat. You're only talking about Thanos. You're not talking about any of the other characters. You've seen those movies. This is not the movie you start with.
No.
Yeah. And so with film in general, look at, for example, and I think a predecessor to all of this mess is Star Wars. Start with episode four, five, and six. Great reveals of, no, Luke, I am your father. Actually, it doesn't say Luke. No, I am your father. If you watch them one, two, three, four, five, six, then in episode three, it's very clear because his wife is pregnant. She delivers twins, names them Luke and Leia, and then dies.
Yeah,
And so
total spoiler.
two films later, so with gravitas says, no, I am your father. It's like,
Duh.
yeah, okay, we knew that. It's a bit of a shock for Luke, I guess, but if you watch episode five by itself or first, my God, that's an earth-shattering reveal.
Yeah,
I
remember at the
watched.
time in 1980, I didn't believe it. My brother and I thought that Darth Vader was lying.
That fucking crushed my world, but at the same time, it's like, man, that's the best fucking movie ever. But man, I gotta wait 3 years to find out what happened to Han Solo. That was also kind of a disappointment, though. I hate the Ewoks, like the Porgs of the 80s. But I mean, because of that kind of stuff, you now have this kind of stuff where, you can refer forward and backward, and you just have to. It's like w looking at a word jumble and having to make a sentence out of it. If
Well,
you understand the grammar, you can.
yeah, well, and in this movie, once again, we have something about Peggy Carter and something about Howard Stark. about both of them dying, but still, they managed to get those guys into this movie too.
But they're not letting go of Peggy Stark. Was it Peggy Stark?
Peggy Carter.
Yeah, Peggy Carter, sorry.
And Howard Stark.
So Peggy Carter, they're not letting her go either. They're doing the What If series where she's going to come back as Captain America, or what is it?
Oh, yeah.
Captain Carter.
Female version of Captain America or something.
They decided not to call her Captain Britain because there's a possibility that Captain Britain will actually show up in a future movie. But anyway, it gets really, really tangled, and then you have to kind of retroactively do stuff, like with the Captain Marvel film, which takes place before all of this shit.
Yeah, in the 90s.
So it
Well, considering what they had done to the Earth in Infinity War, they couldn't very well set it in the present.
well, I suppose after half the world is dusted, then they take a break and tell this story about this woman who's a fighter pilot. It's kind of weird, but there's part of a conversation there that I need to have with you after we watch Endgame. So continuity and context is everything. But they can recontextualize everything with the next film. And in fact, that is going back to Star Wars, that's something that they're planning to do for episode 9. Seeing how episode 8 left such a bad taste in everybody's mouth, episode 9 is supposed to retcon that a little bit, but also recontextualize it. So you look at 8 and say, that wasn't so bad. I kind of see what they were going for. Fans aren't having it so far. Or I should say haters at this point, because,
Yeah, hate watchers, yeah.
Well, yeah, I'm a little bit of a hate watcher at this point, but that's why I say, it's either entertaining or it's Schadenfreude. I'm going to get mine either way. But looking at that, that didn't used to be a thing. The film was either good or bad on its own merits, but now everything is connected and interwoven, so nothing stands on its own. Yeah, and actually bringing some of my friends to these films, one of my friends, yeah, I think you know her, Noriko.
I've met her a couple times, yeah.
Yeah, she went with me to Age of Ultron, and she had a shit ton of questions after Age of Ultron.
Yeah, can imagine.
And after that, she's like, I'm out. I'm done. The film wasn't good enough for me to figure this shit out, and I don't want to get involved in anything that complicated again. And I can kind of understand it. And my girlfriend, she's just like, what makes you think I would like this kind of movie? And so that's out as well. But I mean, it's really hard to get people into it, especially when I can't say that because it's a spoiler free. Never mind.
Okay, but yeah, because there are so many movies, and it takes quite a few hours of viewing before you get to the really good stuff.
Well, I mean, it's an escalating thing. So the first movies that we watched, they were good in their own right, but they're getting better. And once you get to Civil War, you can't go back and watch the first Avengers or the second Avengers, definitely, and say, okay, those are good films, because you know that there's better. They're okay films.
Do you like comics? The 1960s? How about middle-aged gay couples gossiping about their neighbors? Then you'll love Checkered Past.
A loving examination of DC's Go-Go Check branded comic magazines published from February 1966 to August 1967.
I'm Dr. Bob.
And I'm Dr. Husband.
And each week we'll be your hosts on a trippy tour through mid-century four-color madness. Checkered Past. Available wherever fine podcasts are downloaded for free.
This movie also tricked me. Tony gets that information from what I think it was from the Berlin police on his phone, and finding out what's really going on with Bucky, and Bucky wasn't the one who set the bomb at the UN. And I thought, okay, now all the Avengers are going to come back together and they're going to fight all those other Winter Soldiers, and I was completely wrong. Of course, just the fact that Zemo kills the frozen Winter Soldiers instead of reactivating them is certainly a twist for any viewer, I would think, because just the assumption is he's going to wake them up and command them and wreak havoc, and that was never his intent. So I thought that was interesting.
Well, if he had reawoken the Winter Soldiers and pushed that way, it would have been a really boring movie. It would have been an escalation for a future film, but the dramatic tension would be lost with what they had. So having him kill them solved a lot of problems and kept it really focused on just Tony and Bucky and Cap. So I think the route they took was the better route. And actually, to have him wake up the Winter Soldiers and have them fight on his behalf against the Avengers at that point would have been at best a repeat of the Berlin airport sequence. But at worst, it would have been just a slog to watch.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah.
Now, I did know that Spider-Man was in this, and I did enjoy seeing him, and Hot Aunt May. it was interesting to me that Spidey has already existed for some time here, even though he hasn't been seen on screen. There was one mention of him at the end of Ant-Man. I think it was the hot writer who mentioned him in that last sequence. Is the fact that Spidey has already been having adventures off screen meant to imply that it's been happening in the Sony films?
I believe so. I believe so. Hold on a second. Because if we look at it was Amazing Spider-Man, right?
That was the reboot, I think, of the Sony.
Yeah. Well, okay. So we had Amazing Spider-Man.
We had Spider-Man 1, 2, 3, and then Amazing Spider-Man with Garfield the cat.
The cat.
I think 1 and 2 of that series.
Right. Now, 1, 2, 3, in part one with, what's his name?
Tobey Maguire.
We've got the death of Uncle Ben. And then in The Amazing Spider-Man part one, I think, if I remember correctly, we've got the death of Uncle Ben again.
I believe so, because I know someone was cast as Uncle Ben in that one.
Yeah, I don't remember exactly. It was kind of a what kind of movie. And then The Amazing Spider-Man part two, they spent so much money trying to prop it up. At this point, they're trying to get themselves into a position where they're going to be the next MCU. And it underperforms. Even though it made a lot of money, it really underperformed. I think at that point, this is the thing that blows my mind. Sorry, a little bit review adjacent here, but the box office for Amazing Spider-Man 2 is $709 million. And the box office for Venom was $800 million. But with the box office of Venom, they're looking at it as a smash hit. But they're looking at the box office for Amazing Spider-Man 2 as a terrible flop, which led them to lend out this character to
Marvel Studios.
Marvel Studios. Yeah, and by the way, Amazing Spider-Man 2 was in 2014.
Okay.
And so just 2 years later, all right, you're in the MCU.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of think at this point, Marvel looking at, I remember at the time, there was very much a discussion of, okay, we've got a rebooted character with the same origin story, just new actors.
There have already been two movies that has origin story in them.
Yeah, and then here they're going to do the origin story again.
Yeah.
So it gets really, really tired, and people are already like, okay, we know about Uncle Ben. We're sick of hearing about Uncle Ben.
Mm-hmm.
And Truth and Responsibility, or Power and Responsibility. That was it. Yeah, we got
great
that.
Power,
we got
great
that.
Responsibility. Yeah.
Yeah. So they sidestepped all of that shit, said, okay, that happened already. We saw that in another movie. Now he's just here.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to get a Tony Stark upgrade.
Now, I'm wondering, is Uncle Ben a character that Sony has the rights to, and so they can't mention him here?
It has been suggested that all of the characters outside of Spider-Man are not usable, which is why they all are a little off in the MCU.
Like MJ is hot.
Yeah, and MJ is not exactly MJ.
Mm-hmm.
MJ is short for Mary Jane, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's...
You mentioned before. I forgot what it was now.
Michelle something, I don't know. But anyway, so for all of that, I mean, all of that kind of points to a 25% difference clause for licensing and this whole deal. That a lot of different franchises seem to be doing when they have to split their licensing agreements. I don't know if that's just a thing in Hollywood now, or if it's just a couple of studios that did that, but I've seen it in a couple of cases now, and it seems to be in Star Wars, Star Trek, and now MCU with Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
Or I should say no longer with MCU and Spider-Man. But anyway, I regress.
Or digress.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, so
digress. But, thank you.
Yeah.
I'm an English teacher.
Maybe you are regressing. I don't know. but I thought, you know, I actually put Peter's line here in my notes. When you can do the things that I can, but you don't, and then the bad things happen, they happen because of you. And I thought, you know, rights issues aside...
poetry. Pure poetry.
I thought that it was realistic that Peter might not just want to come out and tell Tony specifically what happened and just give it to him in general terms.
Yeah, actually, I do remember that. And I remember it being not a bad line, but just to hear you say it now, it's like, that's kind of wordy. But maybe for an older man, he was, with his dying breath, would be able to make it very succinct. But for a teenage kid, it's just a word salad. And so, yeah, I can see it. It was a nice way to kind of segue away from that. But coming to, and this is just a very, very minor spoiler for you, two films into Spider-Man, and there's been no appearance of Uncle Ben, people are beginning to have questions about, well, where is Uncle Ben? That is a major part of Spider-Man's story, but we seem to be missing it in the MCU. And so, I don't know. What do you think? Is Spider-Man not Spider-Man without the lesson? Without the lesson being on film, right at the forefront of everything he does?
Well, I mean, I think if you assume that this is a continuum from one or the other set of Sony Spider-Man movies, you could kind of think it is there. And, you know, as you were just saying, nobody really wanted to see the Spider-Man origin story again. And so, you know, this line of his that I just read off is sort of a jumbled version of "with great power comes great responsibility." So, I don't know. I mean, yeah, if it wasn't there at all to point, I mean, if everybody gave up if Spider-Man went into, what's the word? You know, out of copyright. It'll never happen. But what if Spider-Man went out of copyright and someone completely unrelated to Sony or Marvel Studios was doing a Spider-Man movie and they skipped Uncle Ben, then that would be weird. But in this context, I think it's okay to skip Uncle Ben.
Okay.
Now, I did not know that Black Panther was in this movie. So that was a pleasant surprise. But the thing is, you know, being a comics reader sort of spoils some reveals. So, you know, when he takes off his mask, you know, that was no surprise. The surprise was at the UN when T'Challa showed up. Like, oh, T'Challa's in this movie.
What did you think of the Black Panther?
Yeah, I thought they, you know, they really hit the nail on the head. He seems like he's straight out of the comics. As iFanboy pointed out, Bucky also, or the Winter Soldier more specifically, does seem like he steps straight out of a comic. They got his look and everything exactly right also. It was really interesting to see Black Panther in here. That reminded me, though, of, I think it was also in the iFanboy review, they were mentioning that, you know, some non-comics readers in the audience when they watched it was, you know, shocked when it turned out that the Winter Soldier was Bucky. Where, you know, I was kind of jealous of that person because I knew that going in. So it was no shock for me.
You know what it was for me?
What?
I'm watching the Winter Soldier and they're like, Bucky? And it's like, wait a minute, he knows him? How does this? And then they kind of go through the plot and like, he's his friend from the first movie. It's like, nah, he wasn't in the first movie. And then what kind of bullshit is this? They didn't even hire the actor from the first movie to get. And I was calling it out in my mind, like all through the film. And then I go back and watch the first movie. It's like, oh shit.
There he is.
With a haircut. I was blinded by a haircut.
Yeah, his hair is different, so.
Yeah.
But yeah, I thought it was interesting too that, you know, Black Panther gets a large role in this movie, you know, kind of leading into his solo movie that's, you know, a few films down the road for us at this point. Where Doctor Strange, which is the next movie we watch, he's gotten nothing up to now. He got one brief mention in, I think it was Winter Soldier. But you know, that's all we've got on Doctor Strange.
What was the mention in Winter Soldier?
Oh, I don't remember now. It seems like it was near the end of the movie.
Huh.
I can't remember specifically anymore. Seems like it might have been brought up when one of the Hydra guys who had been in S.H.I.E.L.D. was arrested, but I don't remember what the line was anymore. But yeah, there was a brief thing where I think several superheroes were mentioned, and one of them was Doctor Strange.
That's kind of curious, but that gets real tricky.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to continue that after you watch the film, but
okay.
Yeah.
Something else I caught watching it a second time, you know, the crash, you know, when Bucky is attacking the Starks in 1991, and we see that crash three times in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at the beginning and then in the middle, when it's revealed, you know, what Howard Stark had in the trunk,
right?
You know, that super soldier serum that was used by the Russians. And in that second appearance, we're briefly introduced to the fact that the whole thing was on camera.
Mm.
I thought that was kind of nice that they just introduced that idea briefly there. There's one shot that's from the camera.
Mm.
And then, you know, that becomes important in the third time we see it, when we find out, you know, who was in the car.
Right, right.
And apparently the Russians put the camera there. I'm not sure why that camera was there, but or was it some kind of a security camera? I don't know. That was never explained, but
So wait, that was 1991.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And I'm not sure what kind of security cameras there were in 1991, but
Yeah, not that point as much as, you know, I was alive in 1991. In fact, in 1991, I was 20 years old. And being alive at that point, remembering Robert Downey Jr. at that point, he was not that young. So they're making him seem a little bit younger than he actually is.
Hmm. Yeah, well, I guess I think it was on Wikipedia I saw that they were copying how he looked in Less Than Zero.
That was an 80s movie, right?
I think he was like 20 years old at that point in 1987, I think it was.
Yeah, he did have that look of, man, with this paycheck, I'll be able to take so many drugs. Kind of look on his face. But yeah, I think that was just before the downfall. Now he's like the richest fucking actor in the world.
Yeah. Wikipedia had some interesting points about certain characters who are not in this movie.
Mm.
So Nick Fury is absent, which was kind of a surprise to Sam Jackson because the Russos had told him he would be in. But I'm not sure why he ended up not, why they told him that and then he wasn't. But the executive producer, Nate Moore, said Fury wouldn't have added anything to this. And Christopher Marcus, one of the two writers with Stephen McFeely, Marcus said they didn't want Fury to choose any particular side because that's not his place in the universe.
Interesting.
So, yeah, they didn't want to have to make him choose. Similarly, Hulk was left out because, well, Marcus said as soon as Hulk joined a side, the fight would be over.
Yeah.
And also, they didn't want to reveal yet where Hulk was and why.
Mm.
I don't know what movie that is revealed in, but They had also considered having Hope Van Dyne becoming the Wasp in this movie, and they decided...
Have what?
Hope Van Dyne.
Oh, right.
To, you know, she was presented with the Wasp costume in the mid-credit scene of the last movie.
Yeah.
But they decided that it wouldn't be fair to the character to cram that in with all, everything else going on in this movie. So they put that off. And Pepper Potts is gone because Gwyneth Paltrow's contract was up.
Oh, interesting.
Does she ever come back?
Yeah, she does.
She does. Okay. Yeah. So, but at the time, 3 years ago, she didn't have a contract with them. So.
Okay. I don't know, because her contract was up, and also Natalie Portman's contract was up. In fact, Natalie Portman was rumored to be really aggressively against her position in the Marvel films, but her contract has now been renewed.
Yeah.
She will be in Thor 4.
Yeah.
You saw that press conference?
Yeah, well, we've talked about that before. Yeah, when we talked about the upcoming films on critiquing comics.
Yeah, see, my mind is sharp for the continuity of these films, not so much for our conversations.
You need to go back and review all the podcasts.
Yeah, right.
Now, I was happy after the last few movies to see that in this one, the mid-credits and post-credits scenes were pretty substantial in terms of what was in them. It wasn't just like a clip from the next movie or nothing as at the end of Age of Ultron.
Yeah.
You know, we had Bucky going into suspended animation in Wakanda in the mid-credits scene. And that makes me want to ask whether that's a factor in the Black Panther movie. I'm not sure if I want an answer or not, but
I will let that one ride for now.
Okay.
If you really want to know, you can ask me again sometime. But okay. You'll find out either way.
Yeah, that's true.
When we get to Black Panther.
Right. And then at the end, Peter Parker discovering the spider signal that he got from Tony.
Yeah.
And by the way, this Peter Tony relationship also has some basis in the comics Civil War story.
Okay.
I don't quite remember how it happened there, because, of course, Spider-Man was much more established in the comics universe by that point. But he did end up forming this sort of relationship where Tony was sort of a mentor to him and right. gave him a different costume and other tech.
Mm.
So, that is actually following the comics also, sort of.
Okay. That's good to know. I kind of felt weird about, I mean, the relationship in this film, not so much. In later films, a little bit. What exactly is this? And are they cutting this out of whole cloth, or what are they doing? You've read Spider-Man before, right?
Oh, yeah.
And you claim to like this character and know a bit about him.
Yes.
What is the deal with Peter's parents?
Well, they have explored that in the comics. I can't remember if I've actually read that one, but I've certainly read about it or heard about it. That I think what they established was that his parents were like spies or something.
Oh, interesting.
And were killed. And that's why he was with Uncle Ben and Aunt May.
Okay, so they explored that in Amazing Spider-Man 1 and 2. They brought up this subplot of, look, Peter, we've got to go out of the country for a little bit, but we'll just leave you with your aunt and uncle for just a couple of days now. And then they go off and die, and he's kind of stuck there. But in part two, they kind of go back into kind of a flashback sequence of, you know, There was more to that story, and they're teasing it out slowly. So part one and part two are both kind of introductory. What is it, like the first 10 minutes of each film is a little bit of a cliffhanger minisode before the film starts, or I guess before the film, the main plot gets going. Mm-hmm. But it was kind of a ridiculous idea that these were super science spies.
Mm.
And they had developed some sort of spider serum or something, or some sort of serum that was based on Peter Parker's father's DNA. So the only person who could actually be bitten and get those powers would be Peter Parker. So it adds a layer of impossibility to the odds of a radioactive spider biting Peter Parker, because those two incidents are years apart. But I remember looking at this in the theater and going, "Oh my God, this is so terrible." but I'm guessing that it was also not incredibly interesting in the comics.
So I'm looking it up here. So in Amazing Spider-Man Annual number 5 from 1968, they revealed their backstory. Let's see. Yeah. So they both became, I guess, special forces agents, and giving them both an easy cover as a married couple. They were assigned to investigate Baroness Adelicia von Krupp, who had captured an agent of a friendly power, who turned out to be, this is a total retcon, who turned out to be Logan, a.k.a. Wolverine, then a Canadian operative called Agent Ted. They rescued Logan from the Baroness and Baron Wolfgang von Strucker. Oh, there he is. After that mission, they discovered Mary was pregnant. Logan was actually the first person to congratulate the Parkers, commenting later that he never saw an agent as tough as Richard Parker go that white that fast. They are believed to be the parents of Teresa Parker, who followed in their footsteps as a CIA agent, but her relation to them has not been confirmed. Their son Peter was often left in the care of Richard's older brother Ben, much older, and his wife May when Richard and Mary were away on missions. While on a mission to investigate Albert Malik, the third Red Skull, they posed as traitors and double agents to infiltrate his criminal organization in Algeria, ultimately being discovered. Malik had an assassin kill the two by sabotaging their airplane and causing it to crash. They were subsequently declared missing in action and presumed dead, as two burnt bodies were found in the remains.
All right. That does kind of coincide with the Sony Amazing Spider-Man bit. But, I mean, it's all just a little too much.
Well, you know, it would have been boring if they just, you know, got in a car crash and, you know, he was like a dentist or something.
Yeah, now I'll tread lightly here because I understand that you did like this show at one time. But this kind of plotting and connecting of characters is something of the ilk of Days of Our Lives or General Hospital, and is entirely incredulous and clumsy at best.
Yeah, it is a little annoying that they retconned it to put Logan in that story. Who really needs that? But yeah, I mean, I used to watch General Hospital, and yeah, you know, it was coincidence after coincidence.
Yeah, at a certain point, you know, you can no longer be shocked by their reveals.
Yeah,
and it's like, okay, that's where you're going with that, and to be honest, that's why I stopped watching that hospital show with George Clooney. What was it called?
Oh, ER.
Yeah, I stopped watching ER because I could see the plot points coming a mile off. I only made it to season 4. George Clooney left and I was done. But anyway, I digress.
Okay. Anything else we need to say about this?
About the film itself. Up until this point, this is my second favorite film.
After what, Winter Soldier?
After Winter Soldier. Because Winter Soldier was surprising. It surprised me, and it pushed it into a sphere of logic that Marvel movies didn't really have, or that I didn't quite see. It was a little goofy and all a little tongue in cheek, but Winter Soldier took itself seriously, and I could actually swing with that. This one also kind of continued that line. I just like Winter Soldier a little bit more because I just like Captain America in the films anyway a little bit more. Yeah.
It is interesting that this was considered labeled as a Captain America movie rather than an Avengers movie.
Everybody commented to that. And actually, one last point. At the very end, it said Spider-Man will return.
Yeah. I suppose it's because they put the Winter Soldier stuff in it, and so that makes it a bit more a Cap movie than a movie about everybody else.
Yeah, but it is very much an ensemble. This is Avengers 3, but like they couldn't wait for it. So, And I think this is the first time that all the heroes began just kind of appearing in other people's movies. Mm-hmm. I mean, aside from a cameo here and there, they had everyone except for Hulk and what's his name?
Thor.
Yeah. So, one last question. Would you have signed, if you were a powered person, would you have signed the Sarkovia Accord, or would you have gone rogue?
Ooh. Well, I don't really see the benefit of going rogue. I mean, it would be annoying to be under, you know, bureaucracy telling you what you could and couldn't do, but which threats you could address and which you couldn't, and maybe something that you didn't think was a threat they'd tell you to deal with anyway. But yeah, I don't know.
Well, before you answer that, let me suggest something. That you watch The Boys.
I haven't seen it. I know you liked it, but
very much. Watch The Boys, and it'll help you make your decision. But anyway. For myself, I would probably have signed it because I'm more of a lazy jobber than a superhero man of action.
Yeah, I probably would end up signing it too, although then I might end up retiring. I don't know.
Yeah, take the Hawkeye route. Go rogue if you have to.
We've got breaking everybody out at the end. And I assume that there's nothing about this in Doctor Strange. Mm-hmm. Any thread left over from this movie?
I do you want me to tell you?
Just a yes or no.
What is the question?
Is there any plot thread from this movie that runs through Doctor Strange?
Not to my memory.
Okay. All right. Well, this, just like the movie, I think this is the longest one yet, this podcast.
They get longer, so don't worry. We'll get longer too.
Okay.
All right.
All right. So Doctor Strange next time. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Malele.
Sure. Thank
All right.
you.
All right. We'll see you next time.
Bye-bye.
Next week on Deconstructing Comics, Kumar and Dana talk about the new IDW collection of 1950s EC Comics stories, Best of EC Stories Artisan Edition. See you then!